Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. I'm MVArts. If you're new to the channel, please subscribe to the channel and also like this video. In this video, we're gonna see how we can easily create butter smooth camera animations inside of Blender. If you have seen other videos on this topic, I'm gonna guarantee you this is gonna be different. We're not gonna record the camera movements. We're not gonna use constraints and paths. We're just gonna do an easy camera rig, easy to use, clean and smooth. So some of the topics in this video are gonna be setting up the rig, of course. Then how are we gonna use the rig? What are the movements? What is capable with this rig? It's not even a rig, it's so simple. Then we're gonna see if we can make a handheld feeling. And if you're interested, we're gonna do a Vertigo effect, or also known as a Dolly zoom. There's gonna be more, stay tuned. Inside of Blender, I've built a scene, and of course we want to make a camera inside of the scene. This is gonna be the easiest camera rig you've ever seen. Don't worry about it. We're gonna create a camera with Shift A and go to camera. There you go. Where are you? Here you are. Move it to a new collection, call this camera.rig. I wanna cancel out all the transformations and move it up on the Z axis. So we're gonna create an empty. I like to use a cube. Again, it is in the wrong collection, but move it to the camera rig collection instead. And with this empty cube selected, we can hit Alt S, Alt R, and Alt G. Grab the camera, grab the empty, Control P, and say Object. If we go into the camera mode, you can see we're now on top of the character. Right. So I briefly touched on this before, but I saw other methods as well that are using the viewport controls to navigate the camera and then record it using AutoKey while playing on the timeline. Of course, this is nice. This is a super inventive way as well. However, I'm not really a fan of this method because you have to plan out your animation quite far ahead. And also you have to clean up the curves in the curve editor. It's just one step extra, and I really don't see the need for it. Then again, you can use path and use a constraint modifier, but on the other side, there's little room for tweaks, make a different turn or make the path just slightly different. You can adjust the path, of course, but it's just finicky. Yeah, this method is easy, not much to think about. There are simple controls, and let's get into it, you know? We have set up the camera rig. It's super easy. Let me explain you how to use it. There's not much to it, but go into the camera view, you grab the cube, and you can rotate the cube, move it, rotate it in all directions you want. And I encourage you to always place your empty on the subject so you can rotate around the subject. So this is, for example, a nice and easy way to have a turntable. You see, I'm just gonna show you all the movements that you can make with this camera setup. So, like I said, you could move or you could rotate, but also you could scale the cube and then you move in. You're probably thinking, well, let me go into normal mode to show this. And you're right, you could do a translate, but however, then you move your empty there, and that also moves the pivot point, of course. So there are some benefits to use the scale over the translate. So, but for example, for a flyby, you can use this and move the empty. What I like to do when I drag my timeline up here a bit, I like to keyframe the location, rotation, and scale, and say go in further in time and somewhere around here. And let me go back to global, rotate around the character. I wanna bring it down. Then I wanna scale to move a bit closer. And now I can keyframe the available. That keyframes all the channels that we previously keyframed. Go into the camera mode, camera view. What I like to do is in the camera settings, I wanna go to the camera settings on the right here, viewport display, post per two, and crank up the opacity so we can only see what we see through the camera and not the entire scene around it. Just a side note there. There you have it, there you have a nice little animation. This is the same technique to animate the camera that I used in the Zerker video. If you haven't seen that one, I leave a card up in somewhere here. It's nothing fancy, it's just so easy to control. What makes a camera animation smooth, in my opinion, is that you have nice and clean arcs that replicate the movements of an actual, say, a crane, a camera crane, or you know those tracks, right, where they move around like in a turntable, right? This is just nice. You get it for free, you know, because if you rotate this, you create a nice arc. I can show you. If I go and I select the camera and I want to go into the object tab on the right, I'm going to motion path, and if I say calculate and say okay, I'm sorry I missed that, you can see that we now have created a nice path. What I also did, and I encourage you to do this for things you use a lot, place it under your quick favorites. That's what I did, so it's calculate right here. And the quick menu is Q, the short key, so if you didn't know that, there you go. Like I showed you, this is highly customizable. I select this, and for example, say you want to do somewhere here in between, you want to move a bit more out, set a keyframe there, and calculate the camera. Well, there you have it. You adjust it, and you have a nice clean motion. Even if we add more keyframes to this, and around 60 again, we want to be a bit further along the line, right there, but we want to be a bit more in. Keyframe that, calculate, there you go. So this is the motion path right now. Let's say you want to tweak it. You can go into the graph editor, shift F6, that's what I like to do. Let's say we go to the scale, we select auto scale channels, shift H, select all with A, and hit the period key to bring it up. And you can see how you can easily tweak this, of course. So something like this. And now you adjust the path in a different way, but it was still quite easy. And you have a nice motion path here. So you go in, you go out, and the timing is a bit slow. But I hope you can see that this is so easy to adjust. You don't have to worry about a lot of controls. That's super easy. So now that you have seen how I create my motion path, let's get into the next topic. So first I'm gonna delete all the camera keyframes and reset this keyframe, lock rod and scale, go a bit further to around here. Doesn't really matter timing wise. We wanna zoom in and maybe a bit of rotation. There you go. So yeah, we set that keyframe, go further in time, go out. If you double tap an axis, for example, the X, you get into local mode, and that's important because otherwise you get a bit more of a Dutch tilt. And maybe rotate a bit more like this, for example, set another keyframe available. I set up this quick animation. It's not that brilliant, but I want to talk about a handheld feeling. How can we do that? It's pretty easy. So because we're only animating the empty here, we can add another layer on top of this camera animation by selecting the camera itself. It doesn't really matter what channels you're gonna set the keyframe for, but you wanna go into the graph editor again. I wanna animate the Z rotation. So I'm gonna select the Z rotation here, say N, and that brings up the N panel in the graph editor. Let me make it a bit bigger and go to modifiers in this tab right here, add a modifier and say noise. And that is gonna create this graph that is displaced with a noise modifier. Sort of, that adds this shaking animation to the Z rotation channel. Now you can play with the stretch and the, or this is the scale and this is the stretch, sorry about that. And there you go. So keep in mind that you can do this to every channel. So for example, if someone is walking towards the subject, you have an up and downward motion and maybe also a slight tilt in the camera. Up and down, and maybe even left to right, you can do that as well. So you can say it's the Y because that's the local transformation, and you can say add noise, and then you have a up and downwards motion, and probably have to scale it and stretch it a bit more. So now you go up and down, that's a bit too much of course, so keep it a bit tighter. And there you go, and then use the X rotation again, that's a local transformation. X rotation, let's isolate that one with shift H, say add modifier noise, there you go again, it's a bit much,
stretch it out. So yeah, this is a bit too much, as you can see. But still, you get the gist of it, I hope. So I've deleted the modifiers, and I want to talk about, for the next bit, I want to talk about focus. How do I focus and create depth of field for my scenes? Well, that's pretty easy. In this rig, I say select the cube, cursor to select it, and add a new empty, and this time I'm gonna choose the sphere. It's in the right collection. I'm gonna rename this to focus. Maybe I like to go into the object data properties and adjust the size a bit smaller maybe. So there you go. I go into the camera options down here, if you haven't selected already, enable depth of field, and you could set it manually. And if you want to do that, you can go to the viewport display, show limits, and adjust the distance, and you can see that this cross now is getting closer or further away. But what I like to do is say I use the focus object. So we're going to use focus, type in focus, it's the fourth value, there you have it. And now I have a separate object to control the focus. Now, if we would render this, for example, so now that this is rendered, you can see we have a bit of a depth of field here. I would like to point out that in the camera settings, you have the focal length. The focal length determines the zoom of the camera, if you didn't know that. You can zoom in or you can dolly in. To dolly means to go forward or backwards on a dolly track. So what I would like to point out is whenever you use a high focal length, you get a shallow depth of field. So if you want your background to be more out of focus, I suggest moving backwards with the camera and using a zoom lens or cranking up the focal length. That's how you get a more shallow depth of field. And that brings me to my next point. I highly discourage you to parent these two together, like so. And it seems like that would be a good idea because the focus point always moves with the empty. That seems like a good idea, but I can assure you I tried this many times, and a lot of times you have to counter animate because you want to keep your focus, for example, in the same place, and that is just a lot of counter animating. I promised to show you how to do a focus pull, so let's get on to that. So while I open up this new scene, let me tell you what focus pulling is. Focus pulling is basically pulling the focus from one object to the next. And you see that a lot, for example, in movies where they want to direct the viewer's attention to a specific point in the scene. I opened up a new scene right here. And as you can see, I have the exact same setup for my camera as I did before because I don't need anything else. So what I did here is, let me see if I can find it. Here's my focus point. It's a bit smaller, so let me make it a bit bigger. There you go. And all I did is I animated this and switched between the two of them. And of course, you could have done this by hand, so you would go into the camera settings again, open up and say limits, so you can see where I highly recommend to do this. You always have a visual reminder, so enable limits and open up depth of field, and then you should animate, could have animated this setting right here. But however, the longer your sequence is, the longer your shot is, the more you want to replace the focus, the better it is to have a focus object, in my opinion. I can just pick whip it, and now the focus point follows the empty, as you can see. So that is basically everything I think you should know about focusing in Blender. Moving on to the next part, and the next part is gonna be a vertigo effect. A vertigo effect is also called a dolly zoom. If you're not familiar with the dolly zoom is the official name in the industry, but it's also known as the vertigo effect. And basically it comes to this technique. So for this effect and for my situation, I dollied towards the character and I zoomed out with the camera. So the effect of that is that the character in this case stays relatively the same size, but the background and the perspective of the background changes. So in this case, you can see that the hallway becomes a lot longer and feels more stretched. So practically in Blender, this is, with this setup, pretty easy to achieve. All you have to do is go to a frame you want to start. So this is my starting frame, this is my starting setup, and I set a keyframe for lock rod and scale. Then I moved to frame 100, that's the frame I wanted to end, and I would scale inwards, like so. Then I set a keyframe, of course, and to counter that animation, I selected the camera, went into the camera settings, and from there I started at keyframe 1 again, keyframing the focal length at 82 millimeters, and that was again keyframe 100, and I keyframed the focal length here to 24 millimeters, giving again the following effect. There you go. So as you can see, this is pretty simple to achieve. I combined it with the focus object, as you could see, because when I don't do that and I bring this back like around 5, so this is the right focus point for now, and as I play it, you can see that the focus point moves. So that would mean that I have to go in, set a keyframe here, go to the ending frame, and then set a keyframe again, tweaking it, and like that. And that's where the focus empty comes in again. It's super handy. You don't have to do any animation for the focus points. It's just spot on. All right, so far the vertical effect. The last thing I want to show you is, and I go back to my previous scene. So the next thing I want to show you is switching cameras. What I like to do, I want to select this cube. I want to press Ctrl plus to grow the selection. Now I have the rig and the camera rig. And if I want, I can select the focus point as well. Now I have them all selected. I want to duplicate these. And if you want to be organized, you can rename them. So with rig camera 2 selected, I can delete these keyframes, rotate, rotate again to some other position. I select this camera, say Ctrl and 0. Now I switch to this camera. This is now the active camera. We're not really switching during animation yet. But you can see we have now a different perspective on the character. If you would like, you can zoom in a bit, for example, and there you go. Say during this animation, I would like to change up the camera. Let's do that. I would go and say, this is our active camera for the beginning. Play the animation. There you go, we go in, we go out, and probably at this point I would say I want to switch. How we're going to do that is mark this on the timeline. Marking, you can do hover over the timeline at the frame and press M for MVRs. We can go out of camera mode. So with the second camera selected, we can go into marker and say bind camera to marker. There you go, now it says camera 2 right here. Let's go back to the beginning, do that again, create a marker with M, select this camera. Now using the short key, Ctrl B, we bind the camera 1 to that marker. Now if I play the animation, you can see that we're in camera 1, and at this point, we switch to camera 2. And of course, you could make your animation with this camera as well. So that was the last point I wanted to discuss. With that said, let me know in the comments down below which of the techniques you're gonna use first. If you enjoyed this video, smash that like button. If you want to see more content in the future, hit that subscribe button and the notification bell. As always, stay creative. See you next time. Ciao.